occurs in 30% of the cases, and it is due to inadequate purchase on the lateral cortex. Forces are tremendous and they tilt the head into varus, and that is the cause of failure. Lateral plate improves stability. This is an important advance according to M.J. Parker. Why three cancer screws are laterally unstable? My hypothesis is, when you insert a screw in the lateral cortex, you create a hole which is larger than the shaft of the screw, and there is a space between the screw and the lateral cortex. And this creates a lever arm, a fulcrum at the cortex, and a long lever arm and a short lever arm here. This results in a slight movement at the cortex. We'll get exaggerated movements at the screw level, head level, and toggling occurs. The screw toggles, and that is the cause of 30% displacement. Now, what is the solution? The solution is, you put a sleeve, it will reduce the gap between the cortex and the shaft, and also it will bring the fulcrum medially so that the lever arm becomes almost equal and stability is restored. Problem for both DHS and three cancer screws, large number of meta-analysis, RCTs and papers have described that sliding mechanism causes excessive collapse and leads to healing problems such as non-union AVN, neck shortening, limb shortening, which changes the biomechanics of the hip, which the elderly person will not tolerate. So the current focus is on research is on reducing excessive collapse, which is the main cause of failure. So after intensive research, two concepts have evolved during the last two decades. First is post-operative controlled collapse group, which says that after you compress the fragment, a controlled collapse is necessary. The other group says once intraoperative compression is achieved by three screws or DHS, no more collapse of the head is required. And they have developed what they call next stable implants. So the controlled collapse group, the three big companies of the world, that is Asculab has developed Targon FM, Smith & Nephew Conquest, DepuSynthes femoral neck system. These three systems allow controlled collapse or controlled impaction. Whereas the other group, which says there is no need for controlled collapse, or full use of fully threaded screws, oblique fourth screw, femoral neck plate, and GSK triangular system, and locking head screws. So $1 million question is collapse or impaction necessary after intraoperative compression? And the second question is controlled collapse or controlled impaction the answer? My hypothesis is, if you see fracture neck of femur healed ones, that is about 70% of the cases that we treat, all have no callus formation. What does it mean? It means essentially the healing is by compression, by absolute stability and primary healing, because there is no callus formation. So if you accept this theory that for primary healing with absolute stability, then why do you allow mobility? There should not be mobility if you are treating a primary healing. Mobility is contrary to the principle of primary healing by absolute stability. After compression, there should be no movement of the head to protect the lag effect. So, however, we cannot insert a protection plate, and very difficult, if not possible. It's difficult to put a protection or a neutralization plate in the neck femur. So other methods are used. So what are the other methods? I will tell you the biomechanics of triangle construct, the strength and mystery of triangles. If you connect three rods with hinges and force applied, the triangle will not move because of this phenomenon. But if there are four rods connected with hinges, and if you apply force, the quadrangle will move, as you see here. But if you convert them into triangles, it will not move. This is the miracle of triangles. Similarly, if you take six rods and force applied, it will move. But if you convert them into triangles, all triangles, it will not move. So the bridges and many of the buildings are done on the triangle basis. See, these are all triangles. So triangle is an engineering marvel, stronger than any other design. Huge ball at Disney is done on principle of strength of triangle. See, they are all triangles. Can it be applied to orthopedic implants? Yes. Liver et al. Done a biomechanical studies on cadaver and at the proximal fractures of the head of the humerus, and they found that the triangle construct was the strongest. So on this basis, we developed a plate and sleeves, screws with sleeves, and found that, see, this is a 45-year-old lady, and this is the implant that we have used, and 3 months later, walking full weight bearing, no collapse. Another example, 3 months later, this is the triangle that I'm using. So the GSKT system works on four principles. Plate offers lateral stability. Sleeve prevents toggling of the screws. Lag screws compress the fragments and provide absolute stability. And the triangular system acts similar to protection plate or a neutralization plate. So GSKT system can be applied to any metaphyseal fractures. So it is technically demanding, still needs improvement. Newer implants or deprivation test is the one, this is the one which is recently introduced, Smith and Nephew Conquest. These two are very recently installed, and there is no reports about its utility or any results about it. However, Targon FN has been used since 2007, last 12 years, and there are conflicting reports about it. So anyway, this is another method of Philippov's method, biplane double supported screw fixation. This also works on the principle of neck stable implant. That is, no collapse is necessary on that principle. So in conclusion, after compression of the fracture, collapse is not needed because it's a primary healing. GSKT system has a plate, sleeve, triangle, is a super construct. While using three cancellous screws or THSUs, I suggest to you to use an oblique screw from the greater trochanter to the inferior quadrant of the head. This will be at cross with the three screws or DHS and will prevent collapse. And what is necessary is to prevent the collapse of the head onto the head. So till my system comes into market, use an oblique screw to prevent the collapse of the head. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Tanna sir, your next talk.
I can stick to my subject. This is a case, pre-op operation, and this is after 3 months. As you can see, this fracture which is given, surgeon has done the DHS with the derotation screw, he's tried to fix the lateral, the LT, and that screw has bent. I feel it's almost impossible to fix the LT from the lateral approach because it is situated posteriorly. And when you try to do it from the X-ray, you will go it onto the edge. If you do it CT scan, probably you will realize. Anyway, this was 3 months, and now the 6 months which has gone by with the same thing, and the fracture is not uniting, and the patient is complaining of pain. So the surge now, you can see that the fracture is a vertical. In an IT fracture, as a part of an IT fracture, if the one element is a basal fracture, which is a vertical fracture, this is exactly works like a transcervical fracture with the vertical fracture, which has the forces which are acting on it is not helping the healing. So here, now the surgeon went through and did a DHS. He did a DHS, but still the vertical forces are still acting exactly the same way. Here you can see the DHS which is done, the vertical forces which are acting is the same. The CT scan, it shows a non-union, and then he was for a revision. And into the situation, you can see this is the vertical force acting. This is the subtrochanteric fracture where you have done the DHS. It's not going to work. And this, like usual, it broke down. This is in 6 months' time it broke down. That is the time I came into the picture. And now I started doing everything. I had a PFN, the plate, and everything. I opened it up. And there what happens is, when I opened it up into this vertical fracture, I was planning to do an abduction osteotomy or get this fracture into abduction. And then when I opened it up, there was a big amount of pus, so I just had nothing to do. Now there was a pus, so I did nothing. I just put in some of the antibiotics, cleaned it out, washed it out, and when everything again, the infection was covered, I went down. I went down when everything was there. This is the one now I am faced with. This is the situations. I went down, did the 95-degree plate, into abduction, correcting the deformity, and in this was the situation. The forces which were working is vertical force here, with this 95-degree plate. I converted that vertical force into the abduction force, mainly by changing the mechanics, and this I did it by putting the plate slightly lower down and take it down here, so automatically it will go into valves. Once you put into valgus, then the plate, and the absolutely medial bone graft. Once you do this medial bone graft, this is the stage where the fracture heals up, and that's the reason why the fracture healed up extremely well, as you can see here, and this has healed up completely well. And patient is walking about, moving about, the fracture healing. Now here is the second case. Again you see, there is a vertical element of the fracture. This is the vertical element of the fracture. Again fixed up. This is the one which is fixed up, and then you can see it just walks out. With this vertical element in this sort of a DHS, it does not give stability. And that's the reason when it walks out. Now it has walked out completely out. And the only way which has already been eroded the articular cartilage and the acetabulum is the replacement. So this is the one that we have gone ahead and did the replacement. Vertical element of the IT fracture is the big issue. Corrected at the primary surgery to be into valgus. Now here was the fracture. You can see this is the fracture. And the surgeon planned a nail. And in this piece, tera kya hoga kalia? This is the piece which is there. And then obviously after the nailing, as you can see, this piece flew out. And the whole construction is unstable. Proximally, there is no hold. Now, the hold of this vertical type of a fracture, again, is only by these two screws, which is not enough. And this piece has already walked out. So, only way to treat this fracture was, we have put the fracture down in the valgus position by its deduction, and put in a ethibond tension band wire into this piece, which is already avulsed out. And this is the one which is the PFN, which has occurred. Primarily, I feel this fracture should have been treated by DHS. As you can see, this is another patient which I treated. I don't try to do a PFN in this. And I did this DHS, 100% reduction is there. So do not be sold by PFM. It doesn't solve all the problems in all the fractures. If you are efficient and can execute, that's fine. Otherwise, this is a very simple treatment. You will be able to do it in this particular types of the fractures. Now, here is the one fracture. This is the third one where the surgeon did this fracture. And ultimately, you can see this reduction. And he has fixed it up. This reduction still not very clear. And you can see this is the one which has been fixed up. There is a gap here. And the surgeon fixed it up, carried on. This is day one. You can see the lateral view. The lateral view is not reduced. And if you can fix it up in this position, the lateral view, if it is not reduced, is not a stable construct. Is not going to hold. In an AP view, everything looks perfectly all right. In a lateral view, you can see this is how the lateral view is. It should have been like this. And then the nail would have gone in the center, and this piece would have stabilized onto the shaft. This is what was not done. And then I saw it at this stage 8 months. And I asked for the revision. I asked for the revision of the fixation. Patient refused, as he took the opinion of the original surgeon. Unfortunately, the original surgeon is always hopeful. He doesn't try to change in time, while the other surgeon, if he comes into picture, he can change it. So this is what, in 8 months' time, the original surgeon refused. So wait. Now we waited, and the whole thing has come out. This is 10 months now. This was a healthy 71. In that 1 year time, when she went through quite a lot of psychological problems, and this 71 healthy on day of injury. Now 10 months not walked, depressed, not healthy on day one, even healthy on day one. But after 1 year time, there was no other option for me except to replace and make her walk about immediately. So this is what was replaced. Reconstructed the trochanter with these multiple tension band wires, and this is what is there. If you see what is the odd thing, if you see the odd finding is, this is now, wire has gone all the way down, and that is the one which is doing the migrating it down there. Now the other things are, when we repair the DHS which is done to a replacement, the incision is there. This is an original incision which has been done. And that original incision, in order to do a replacement, I connect this with almost a 80 degree angle and then carry it on. Otherwise, if you make an acute angle, this is going to give rise to the skin problem. This is, I almost all do it all the time in order to correct. Now such fractures on day one, if you need it, if you are not very comfortable, you can do the medialization and the fracture will heal up without any major problem. And this is the one which heals up in 4 months' time. But this, if you put in first screw here, then when it is collapsing partially, this will give way, and this is what has happened to his wake up. He's going, remove the screw, and then probably it will work. But no, surgeon carried on, and that first screw, it gives this non-union. So you have to treat that back into the same position, same thing which is done, abduction, medialization, and the patient heals up. Now here it is, we are the orthopedic surgeon, we must know biomechanics. This chair is wobbling. He tries to see it. He tries to see it in both the positions, whether the thing is all right or no, or whether it is a chair which is wobbling, or it is the surface which is uneven. Now when we confirm in both the ways the chair is wobbling, now with an orthopedic surgeon, we got to correct this biomechanics. All he has done is just remove the things, put in one more washer, and things become all right. That adduction force, convert into an abduction force, and then the fracture will heal up. Thank you very much.
Dr. Babul
Kambal. Top-ended fractures, how to avoid pitfalls. You should understand the anatomy of your fracture, see the fracture configuration, how the proximal fragment is abducted, external rotated, and fixed. The reasons are failure are mainly because of the biomechanics and the quality of bone, which is cortical, with severe comminution most of the time. There are two types of presentation in subtrochanter fracture. Elderly people with a poor bone stock, osteopenia or osteoporosis, and a young patient with a high energy trauma. There are various classifications, but I simply taken whether it is stable fracture or unstable fracture. Stable fracture where it is possible to re-establish bone-to-bone contact of medial and posterior femoral cortex anatomically. These are two different types of fractures. This is unstable and this is a stable variety. The high subprochondral fractures are divided into two types, subprochondral. High subprochondral fracture where blade fixation or extramedullary fixation is better, whereas low subprochondral fracture where nearly interlocking is in treatment of choice. Now this is a high subprochondral fracture. If you see here, where extramedullary fixations are preferred. These are two different fractures, low subprochondral and high subprochondral. And do not mix up the character of these two fractures. In low subprochondral fracture, it is easy to do a nailing interlocking, whereas in high subprochondral fracture, it might be difficult to reduce anatomically, and it might require further few techniques or straight open reduction and fixation by extramedullary fixation. This type of fracture, low subprochondral, nailing is perfect in good reduction. Medial cortex contact is there. However, if you do not take proper cognizance of a type of fracture, there are many complications, implant failure, malunion, and non-union. You should study the different factors, whether it is an osteoporotic elderly or a high velocity trauma in young patients. Proper assessment of the fracture and canal diameter is essential. You should plan whether you want to do a nailing interlocking or extramedullary fixation. Identify whether fracture is nailable or needs extramedullary fixation. There are certain pitfalls during nailing. Starting point which is not proper, varus malreduction, nailing in an unreduced portion, flex malreductions, and distraction at the fracture site, especially if it is many times the fracture might extend into piriformis fossa and open up comminuted fracture where nailing may not be possible. You should see about the distal locking. Do not make any mistakes. Many times proper size of the nail or other implants may not be available and lack of knowledge of type of fractures. In stable fracture, you can do any fixation, maintain the reduction, nail works very well in this stable type of fracture. Whereas unstable fracture, majority are unstable, there is a loss of cortical contact, many times there is a severe comminution and fracture is extended into the greater trochanter or piriformis fossa. Key factor is the reduction. How to reduce? Maintain the reduction during fixation. Fix the fragment, mainly the medial pillar. Reduction is important. CT scan is advisable in all these unstable fractures to know the exact configuration of the fracture pattern. For close reduction, define the major fragment, translation and angulation. Appreciate proximal fragment rotation along the neck axis. Consider hip flexion. Raise the thigh so that you can put your guide wire in proper position. Entry point should be at the tip of the greater trochanter. I prefer just medial to the greater trochanter. Patient is kept supine on fracture table and do not do the reaming in the comminuted fracture. Entry point, as I told you, proximal fragment is abducted and flexed and external rotated. Guide wire and reamer tend to go from lateral to medial, thus reaming more of a lateral and posterior cortex. More lateral entry ends up in the varus deformity. Now, whenever the medial column is stable, close reduction is easy, which is nailable, and you can easily do the fixation in this low subtrochanteric fracture. However, in this high subtrochanteric fracture also, it was possible to maintain good contact maintained during the reduction, and even the proximal nailing was possible. This is after healing, and good healing at the end of 6 to 12 months. There are various types of intermediate nails for this. What is more important, how to take the entry. As I told you, entry medial to the tip of the greater trochanter is preferable. There are certain gadgets where you can keep it on the tip of the trochanter and take entry just medial to your gadget. Always rim proximal and distal fragment. Do not displace the fragment during the reduction. Medial directed pressure while reaming. Check the lateral cortex integrity also. Certain adjuvants are required to play and do the close reduction. Attempt use this particular clamps, a coaxial clamp for stabilization. Many times it is required for mini open reduction and fixation. You can have different techniques of reducing the fracture. You can use hook, you can use a string and pin to control the proximal fragment, or you can use a coaxial clamp. This is one of the simple technique of holding the proximal fragment with the string and pin and trying to control before you take the entry into the, or you can use this particular punch and you can reduce the fragment. You can have clamp assisted reduction of the high subtrochanteric fracture. This was one of the publication where you can use mini open, hold the proximal fragment with the clamp, reduce the fracture, and this was this fixation of a proximal clamp. The key decision is whether it is acceptable in both the planes, whether you have achieved or not. Proceed with a limited open reduction. If it is not possible, with a closed reduction, do not nail the mal reduced fracture. This was one of the comminuted subtrochanteric fracture. We planned properly the segments, control the proximal fragment with an Stinman pin and pass a guide wire, and subsequently stabilize with a PFN proximally and distally. And this is post-op X-ray showing a good stabilization using a long PFN. Another example, similar long oblique fracture. These are all distal subtrochanteric fracture which are nailable.
Hello.
Another example of an distal femoral fractures, controlled nicely with the proximal fragment and stabilized. This was in addition to the control of the proximal fragment. We did a wiring and stabilized the fracture and used a PFN.
देखो आप, लेकिन जैसे अभी कपड़ा भी खरीदने आते तो कपड़ा आगे नहीं फटेगा, ठीक रहेगा, रंग नहीं निकलेगा। फैशन के इस दौर में गारंटी की इच्छा नहीं है ना, गारंटी किसी चीज़ की नहीं है। हम अपनी तरफ से अच्छी जगह भेज